You think you know me?
How we doing, folks? Pete, I missed a few Friday sessions. Sorry about that. I had Florida-itis there for a while.
That's okay. I have Florida-itis, too.
Yeah.
Well, I plan on going down there in April to catch some warmth and a couple of rocket launches. So
I got three more times I'm going down.
Nice.
Yeah. Actually, I'm bringing a good friend and his family down in a couple weeks. And then my children, grandchildren, and wife. Then one more time with just my wife. And then we should open Moo probably the following week. So
nice.
Yep. It'll be interesting. And I think everything works out where I don't miss a Friday. But I no promises.
Well, we can always do this in pre-tape.
Yes, don't we? And we just might do that. We had talked earlier about maybe putting something together. So I'm very lucky. My son, for the last year, Ron, has been torturing me about getting this gentleman on. literally. And so it's the Southwick Time Machine. Is that correct? Yeah, this young man's name is Ross Hazeltine. I did that right. There'll be no nasty mail to me. That's good. I'm good for one or two shots a show. So this is wonderful. So my kid, you know, we've read the stories that you've been doing for years. Never thought I could make this work. I usually wait till 2 or 3 days before I'm supposed to have my show and desperately try to find somebody. So this was a whole week and a half I reached out. To you. And
you did some show prep?
And the funny part is I'm thinking he's from town, in town, and the young man's like, well, I'm in South Carolina. And I'm like, is he on vacation? No, that's where I live, South Carolina. So all this research, everything he does is online, through the phone, what have you. But you would think he was in Southwick at the town hall doing his research, and he's not. It's unbelievable. But that's what technology brings us today, and we're very fortunate to have you on. Sir, how are you today?
Great, thank you. I'm doing very good. Speaking of having Floriditis here in South Carolina, the pollen is ridiculous. So if I'm sniffling a little bit, I apologize for that.
Yeah, I'm nursing a cold myself.
My father worked for the Pioneer Dairy for 35 years, and the Pioneer Dairy owns Del Blanco real estate. So a house became available that the dairy owned. And as a perk of my father working there, he got the house at a discounted rate. So we actually lived right behind the Pioneer Dairy, which was absolutely amazing growing up. I got to go through the plant and know the workers and see the operation from a different view than like the average customer, for an example. So it was really such a blessing.
Literally, yeah. I've been very blessed to know the Colson family over the years. They've helped me quite a bit. But Ann, and so you know Mr. Nutter. I never met him.
Mr. Nutter was a great guy. I absolutely loved Mr. Nutter. I always looked up to him as a kid.
Yeah.
I loved when he was walking me through the plant. He was a very knowledgeable guy, very friendly, absolutely loved kids. He had no problem with me going back there with my father and no problem showing off the equipment and how the production worked. It was very fascinating. And Ann Colson, too, I had a lot of interaction with her. The front ladies in the front office used to babysit me when I was a kid after school and stuff like that. And it was great. I just absolutely loved it. Like I said, my dad worked there for 35 years, and then later on, my mother actually worked there. And for a brief time, I had an uncle who worked there.
Wow.
Yeah.
Very
important. It's been a really part of my life. So I hate to see the condition it's in, but I'd really like to walk through it because of so many memories that I have of it, which are all great memories.
Yeah. It's in rough shape, unfortunately. Someday it'll either come down. It's got to come down now. It's not – they'll never be able to rebuild. And it is what it is, right? It is a great piece of Southwick. Paul was there the other day taking the letters off the wall finally. So the Pioneer Dairy is finally, I glued those on there 15 years ago when I had my concession trailer there. we found him on the ground, and Paul finally took him off. So,
well, I pray that they make their way to the like the Suffolk Historical Society or the museum or something like that, because that would be nice to see those preserved.
Yeah, I actually have a very, very pristine collection of ice cream containers, the pints, the quarts, all of the packaging stuff, because it was all left behind there, and we went and plucked one of each. And same thing, it's like, what do you do with it? You're not throwing it out. It's history, and it's great history. You know, that dairy did so much for that town in its younger days. And then, so Charlie has passed, Ann has passed, but and Pete, I know we've had this discussion. Charlie was the first guy on my radio show the first time I did one 9 years ago, and we lost that footage.
Yeah, I think we did.
Can we put a bounty out there? There's no, there's got to be a way, Pete. Would you,
yeah, Vimeo,
Pete,
Vimeo
you're
wiped
so
out my
savvy.
Account.
You're so savvy, Pete. You just, you know, Christmas is coming. There's got to be a way you can find that video.
I'll have to figure it out. I'll see if I can find it.
It was such great. I mean, he literally talked about they would drive. They had a car parked with the railroad track stuff on it in Feeding Hill Center, the white church on the left. There was a garage behind it. And on Sundays, the trains didn't run. And they would load that thing up and run it down the railroad tracks to Springfield. It was crazy, the stories he would tell. And they're real. They, you know, and unfortunately, that history is gone with him. It's just crazy. So that's awesome. You got to grow up there. I could talk to you for days about Pioneer Dairy, but we're not going to do that today. So you grew up in Southwick.
My grandparents lived on Fred Jackson Road.
Oh, wow.
Since 1955, and my grandmother passed away, unfortunately, in 2021 at age 92.
Wow.
That was sad, but thankfully the house is remaining, it seems like, in the family, which is good, because there's a lot of great memories growing up there.
Sure.
So I always am so blessed, because if it wasn't for my grandmother moving to Southwick, my grandfather back in 55, I probably never would have had that opportunity had my parents not followed suit.
Right.
But, you know, the backstory about that, I did put that in the Southwick Time Machine a while back. My grandparents lived in Springfield, and they were renting a place, and they had my father, and then the landlord forbid any more children. So when my grandmother got pregnant with my Auntie Gail, they were forced to move. So when my my grandmother, what she did is she dropped my grandfather off at work, and she went out looking at real estate, and she happened to go to Southwick, and they were putting up new homes on Fred Jackson Road.
New homes.
New homes. And she bought the very first house on the left on Fred Jackson Road.
Ready wow.
$200 down. So I always count her as my blessing, because to grow up in Southwick, you know, a lot of young people may not appreciate it, but it is a blessing to have grown up in such a great town. So I'm very fortunate for that, and I have a lot of gratitude for that. I never forget that.
Yeah. So, we moved here in 74, 75, grew up in Westfield till then. I think I went to 7th grade or 6th grade in Southwick. And same thing. I left in 84, and then you always in the back of your head, how do I get back? How do I get back? How do I get back? And, you know, luckily the ice cream, whatever my world is, it is at the time. But, you know, old Barb's Bait and Tackle, we end up buying that property, and very happy to be back home. Yeah. You know, it's wonderful. So yeah. History, where did the history buff of you come in? Where did that click?
Well, I got to back up for a second, because you mentioned Barb's Bait.
Oh, so yeah, Barb's Bait.
Yard Road, before I had a vehicle, me and my neighborhood friends, we would always walk up to Barb's Bait, because they had like some snacks and stuff they would sell.
Yeah.
So it was a common commute on our bicycles, or we would take a walk up there or whatnot. So.
Oh, that's true.
I'm glad that you're in that spot. That's great.
Wow. And who did you have? What were the friends back then? What were the last names? Let's go with that. You know, remember a few
of them? Albers, Lamoureux.
Oh, geez.
Winkler.
Wow.
Amir. Yeah, Hess.
Yep. Yeah, the Hesses, yeah.
Yeah. We had a great neighborhood on North Long Yard Road. Absolutely great. It looks a lot different today. A lot of the houses have aged, unfortunately. But
yeah.
It's a blessing to have grown up there.
That's true. You are younger than me. I keep forgetting that. You're. I'm 57. You're in the 40s?
Yeah, 48.
Yeah, there you go. So 10 years is 10 years, yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, that's funny. Wow. Yeah. All right, so when did the history come into play?
I've just always loved history. What I would do is I would travel up and down the East Coast on my motorcycle, and I would go to find like historic ruins and things like that. And I would write about you know, kind of briefly, and you know, post photos of them and stuff like that and share them. And then I happened to actually took a month off, and I went on a motorcycle ride up through the Adirondacks and all through New England. I was visiting different historic sites or whatnot. And I, of course, went through Southwick. But I stopped at the Granville Country Store. And that place just has fascinating history. So I was writing these little short stories and snippets for social media under what I called From Today's Motorcycle Ride. So I was writing the Granville Country Store, and I actually dove really deep into that one. And the history was just fascinating about some old break-ins and the fires that they had and, you know, so forth. One of my favorite stories to research and write about. But that actually is what gave birth to South of Time Machine. So instead of doing just ruins, which I was running out of, I said, why don't I focus on something I love, which is Southwick and Granville and Tolland and the surrounding area, and really condense it and be more of a focus on that way. And then I started writing some stuff that I was submitting to Southwoods. They were kind enough to publish it and everything like that. So I kind of, that kept the momentum going. So,
wow.
And I looked up the prep, and you know, people say, like, why do you throw this stuff out there? Well, I look at it, it's more of a preservation factor for me, because a lot of these stories are untold, or if they have been told, not many people know about them. So it's, you know, broadcasting to a wider audience. You know, and I like that. I like preserving history. I don't like seeing history destroyed. At least here it's in written form. I like that people talk about it and have open discussions about it. And I like the feedback, whether it's good or bad. So it's just been a blessing overall. It's been a great experience. So,
yeah, it truly has. I've enjoyed reading everything that you've printed so far. At least, apparently I never saw the dairy one, so I have to go back and look. But it's like you say, the Granville Country Store. It's been there forever.
Fascinating. Absolutely fascinating history. And sometimes those stories are, you know, my story was a lot of it had never been told before, or not in a long time. A lot of people didn't know about it. And I believe there's a copy of that story hanging up in the Granville Library, if I'm not mistaken.
Wow.
So I get a lot of comments about that particular story, because a lot of the stuff wasn't told. And then there was some stuff that was previously told that I thought was inaccurate. So when I do my research, I'm constantly cross-referencing. That's why it literally takes me months. You know, that Granville Country Store story, I want to say 8 months to write that story.
Wow.
And people are saying, well, you're not working it every day. But really, I am visiting every day, whether it's an hour or 10 hours. Because sometimes I get into it and I don't realize that 8 or 10 hours have already passed. And I'm still researching. I just completely lose track of time, and just because I enjoy it so much. But yeah, a lot goes into it. But I cross-reference everything. It's a lot of work. So just, it's not as easy as just going online and trying to find something, especially with old records. Like, I don't know if you know, but the old Southwick Town Hall, it burned down, and a lot of those records were lost.
True.
So a lot of that stuff, you know, it's hard to come about. So, you know, but the online thing is a blessing. A lot of people ask me how I get the information. It's all public record. You know, there's no back stuff. I believe that, you know, I take a more of a journalistic approach, I believe. I don't do like that creative writing where people try to centralize things. I don't do anything like that. I just try to keep everything. I do everything fact-based and just, you know, tell the facts, lay the facts out in a story format, if you will. You know, now if it's something personal to my heart, like maybe the dairy, for an example, I might interject something as a personal experience.
Sure.
That have been public knowledge or something related to my family. I have published stuff about my family due to contrary belief. You know, I have no problem with that. And had I known some of the stuff ahead of time, especially about my family, I would have asked my family members about it. And I, you know, poor people who've reached out to me, you know, the stories are great. And it's like, don't look at it as something bad. Look at it as like, hey, it's an opportunity to talk to your family members, get some more information. Or if you heard about a story before, maybe this will shine a different light on a piece of information you didn't get. Because as we know with the telephone game, as stories are told, they get kind of lost and they get
embellished.
Yeah.
Yeah, they go every which way but loose, those stories.
Right.
Yeah. And that's all part of it, you know.
Yeah.
But it's amazing. You seem to be able to find, I read the one about the toy gun yesterday. Yeah. You know, the guy chose Southwick to get dropped off like he was a teacher. I mean, it's amazing. It's just amazing what you come up with in some of these stories. And somehow it drizzles back to Southwick. You know, it's just cute. There was another, the Coca-Cola robbery. They counted the money in Southwick.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, absolutely. And when I find stories, usually what I do is I used to look. Now, when I write the longer stories, like Consolidated School, Pioneer Dairy,
right,
you know, landmark stuff, if you will, I actually go and I seek that out. But when I'm trying to get story ideas, like the Toy Gun Bandit, for an example, I just stumbled across something that grabbed my attention. And I had no idea that it was going to go where the story went. And it turned out, I thought, to be a very interesting story. I had no idea it was going down the path that it went. One of my biggest faults when I'm writing a story is I love detail. So I'll even add in some details that have to do with the story, but not maybe what we're discussing. Like that story, for example, is about bank robbery. You know, I added some stuff about like when he sold his house, when he bought his house.
Yeah.
Stuff that really doesn't pertain to the bank robbery, but I just love detail so much. I just add that stuff in because it may be of interest to the readers also. So that's the kind of way I look at it. I'm trying to do better to edit that stuff out. Like I used to put people's date of birth and the date they died in there and all that stuff. Some of that stuff's interest of people who were born and died on the same day. I think stuff like that's fascinating. But I've been trying to edit a lot of that stuff out and really just kind of focus on the story itself and not all the extra stuff. But don't get me wrong, I love that stuff. So.
Well, it gives it credibility in the same breath, though. I mean, and I read that, too, what he bought his house for and what they recently sold for X amount of years ago. So it just ties it in to me. It just brings the credibility part of it's not fake news. This is a real – this really happened. I bought a new toy gun in every gun robbery. And if he didn't get in an accident, they wouldn't have saw the money bag on the seat. You can't make that up, you know. And that's back then, right? Yeah. That's just – it's unbelievable. I guess it's just – I'm amazed that information is still out there. And you're, like you say, it doesn't take a day. It takes weeks, months to find this stuff, but it's there. Like you say, public records. So, and a note, Southwick, we did spend the money a couple of years ago to take all the old stuff, and we did archive it and recopied it. So, not that you can get it any quicker, but we did save it, a lot of the old stuff that was been sitting. Actually sat in the old town library that they recently sold in the cellar in boxes. Wow. You know, so our clerk's department brought it all up. We used CPC money to actually fund it, and then we did copy everything. I don't know if you can get to it, but it's sitting somewhere a little more modern, I should say.
Yeah, I'm just glad it's preserved. That's so important. We're so quick to destroy and erase history, and, you know, I'm so glad that information is now protected and been updated and stuff. I mean, that's just a blessing. I wish more.
Yeah.
Always would follow suit on that. It's so very important. But yeah, it's not easy finding these records. You have to decipher a lot of information, especially old court records. I use those a lot. I use wills and different things, census records, newspaper clippings, magazine articles, all sorts of stuff. But it's a lot of information to go through. So it's very, very time consuming. And then, you know, there's always that avenue of self-doubt. I had that a lot when I started. It's been getting a little bit better because I do not want to publish anything that I don't feel that is 100% true or does either the perpetrator or the victim justice in those true crime particular ones.
Yeah.
You know? Not to go off subject, but a lot of people ask me, well, you paint Southwick in a very bad light. And I certainly don't believe that.
No.
It's just easier and people seem to be more interested in those type of true crime, if you will, stories versus like, oh, this big wedding or this big event that happened or something of a more happier tone. Those, unfortunately, are more harder to find than the true crime stuff. It's just the reality of the situation. I mean, I would love to just constantly always paint Southwick in a great light because I love the town so much. I've been accused of not liking Southwick, and it's not. That could be further from the truth. I absolutely love Southwick. I'm so thankful, like I said, to have grown up there, had my grandmother, my grandparents have lived there until they passed on. Went to Southwick High School. It'd always be Southwick High School to me. I absolutely love that.
Yeah.
A lot of memories there and a lot of great teachers. That were such a blessing. I think my love of history came from Ms. Basic and Mr. Deanny. They taught history and social studies. Just fantastic teachers. They're absolutely great. And I think that's where that love actually came from them. Because I saw the passion in them and that passion transferred to me. And I just absolutely love it.
Well, so, we don't teach passion anymore, so you don't have to worry about it.
It's sad.
We just, I mean, and that's a whole nother headache, but it just, yeah, you're right. And there is, you know, how do you say this? There's some older folks left. I just went on a trip to Florida with I'm going to screw his age up. We're just going to say he's 82. He's probably just 80, but you know, I'm 57, but that 15 years difference is huge. You know, the stuff, you know, well, the, you know, where the high school is, there was three barns there before that. And, you know, the cops would look for us, but if you did it right, you could go through the cornfield, have your party, and the kid behind you would put the corn stalks back up. So the police wouldn't, and I'm just flabbergasted, like, geez, that 1984, I didn't think of that. But, you know, back in, you know, 61, these kids are putting the corn stalks back up so they could party in the field, which is now the high school.
Right.
You can't make that up. And that's going to die with that gentleman because there's just nobody. Unfortunately, these younger kids, nobody cares. I mean, I shouldn't say it in that way, but like you said, thank God you're around. The Starries are the Starries. Yeah, they're not perfect. I get it. You offend somebody. Well, that's life, and that's what we do nowadays. But, no, I'm just an honor to talk to you.
I appreciate that, and I appreciate you having me on. That's great. And the, I want to say I do get my fair share of hate mail, and it's okay. It is what it is. But I do get more positive responses. And I actually get a lot of requests from people who want me to do some research on their family, surprisingly, about living family members. I find that interesting. I usually shy away from that.
Yeah.
Even with the time machine, I shy away from that quite a bit. And I always try to go back until the earlier part of the century or the 1800s or what have you. But unfortunately, you can't always do that. So there have been some controversies and some hate mail regarding some stuff that was posted from the 50s, 60s, 70s. I think the 80s were in there also. But there's no malicious intent, which I've been accused of.
No.
A few people I've written about, I didn't know them, maybe personally, but I've known them. I wrote about some neighbors that I had. I knew of them, but I didn't particularly know them. They had a very controversial, for their whole life was very controversial. And I did get a lot of flack for that. But at the same time, I got a lot of positivity out of that. But I really like when people don't just throw out their negative information, especially if they feel like a story is wrong or they can add something to it. I want to get the photo, the correct information that they feel needs a correction. Don't just say something's not correct, which has happened, and then don't offer what's incorrect. That doesn't do anybody a disservice. It actually ruins that other person's credibility. So when I get those, I take them with a grain of salt, but I still go back and I double check all of my information. And so far, that's only happened a few times, but there was nothing that I saw that I reported that was incorrect. So I wish that people would, if you are going to throw out those accusations, have something to back it up. But I love when people have firsthand knowledge. I actually posted a story about my grandfather because I was accused of not posting stuff about my family, but I have. My grandfather in, I want to say it was 1950, less than a year before my father was born, my grandfather was up at Westover Air Force Base. He was in the military, and I forgot exactly what it was. He backed over or ran into somebody there and injured him, quite a bit. And then for whatever reason, he took off. He left. He left the scene. And it was all over the news, and then he turned himself into the police. So I posted that story, and I didn't know really what happened. I just thought it was a done deal, but the gentleman's who got ran over, his son actually reached out to me, which I thought was fantastic, and he thought the story was great. He gave some really good feedback on it. But he provided me a picture of his injured father right shortly after the accident. He was in a cast and had crutches and everything. Stuff like that is absolutely fantastic. That's what I love.
Right.
Well, you can add something to the story, a piece of missing information or just a photograph or something like that. Someone once sent me a picture of Orinoco Bank when it was up on the hill at Southwick Plaza. A great photograph. I had never seen it before. It just blew my mind because it had a really great sign for the bank on the rooftop.
Yeah.
Absolutely beautiful. It reminded me of the old Southwick Pharmacy. That's where Southwick Package is today. That was another great sign. Just stuff like that. You just don't see that. Those great lettering and those great signs anymore. So I was really happy that someone shared that with me. So I love receiving like that. Somebody sent me some information on Congamon Lakes. Some ice house information and stuff like that's great. I really do appreciate the fans who take the time to do that. And I really wish that would happen more often. So
yeah, looking back, we were a big part of the 250th anniversary in Southwick, my nonprofit side, and also the parade. And with COVID, it got postponed and yada yada yada. But we had some footage of the parade 50 years before, and you can see the Orinoco Bank. And it wasn't the summer house. It was Friendly's, So it's like you say, there's just so much of history. If you can just slow down and we're laughing, looking at the cars, but then you start looking at the background wait a minute, So yeah, you're right. There's a ton there and you just got to find it.
So you had mentioned that you have some Pioneer Dairy stuff in your collection. I too have a lot of Pioneer Dairy stuff in my collection, which I'm very blessed for.
Yes.
I don't know if you remember, but in the middle of the window of the office at Pioneer Dairy, there used to be this great neon sign.
Yes.
Pioneer Dairy on it, and I don't know whatever happened to that. I really hope someone preserved it. It was a beautiful sign, and I really hope somebody hung on to that.
Yeah, the whole thing was unfortunate. We were there. We were a customer when they closed. It's just too bad the way it closed, the way that whole process happened. They had an auction. And they sold everything they could sell over there, and you know, who knows where the sign ended up. Maybe hopefully one of the boys have it. But right. But yeah, you're right. You know, even like the, you know, the world famous fudgicles, right? You can't, you know.
Fudgy Frost. Everyone calls them fudgicles.
But yeah, but the fudgies.
Yeah, the fudgy frost was the technical one.
Yeah, yep. Yeah. Unbelievable. Yeah. That vat that they made them in is still there, but just the vat.
Really?
The rectangle box, of the, you know, at least according to Brett, the stuff would go into there, blah, blah, blah. But that's there. The other piece of equipment was left was the machine to make the 3-gallon tubs to score them and to connect the cardboard. That was still there. A little bit of the conveyor was left, and that's about it. You know, everything else got pretty much ripped out of there when they had the auction.
I would love to walk through there and just see it. Bring back a little bit. I had to make great memories. I used to ride that conveyor belt.
Oh, jeez.
So a lot of great memories there. But yeah, my favorite memories were, and I, like I said, I always see Paul and Brett back there. They worked there, and Ann Colson.
Yeah.
And Mr. Nutter, that was always great. But I just loved operating that machine. When my father would get called away, he would just grab me, hey, guys, put these in the, because the machine never stopped. The milk just can't come out. So if you didn't put it in the milk crates, it's eventually just going to fall on the floor. So you have to really stay on top of it. Sometimes, I mean, it would sneak up on you if you got a little slow, you know. So that was always fun, and I always really enjoyed that. Always going to work with Dad was always just such a blessing. And then after hours at the dairy, we would ride our go-karts and our mini bikes in the back off parking lot. We would go sledding when Charlie was out there putting the snow mounds.
You know,
from the parking lot, we would ride our sleds and make snow forts and do all that. That was fun.
Yeah.
And I called it in the back of the dairy. You know, when I lived there, there was no fence originally. That green fence was not in existence.
Right.
So you would just walk from market, the grass would stop and the pavement would begin, and you just would openly go freely. So when they put the fence up, they put a gate there for my parents to go, you know, back and forth to work. And our neighbor, Mr. Breeden, would walk through and cut through. And Joe Zanoli, who worked there, he would go through and cut through. So we would have that path. Our go-kart just happened to fit through there perfectly. It was such a blessing. I mean, it was like just perfect. The tires would just be hitting like the fence pole, but we'd go riding back there. But behind the further part of the fence, there was where the old dairy trucks, so they were no longer in service, they would go. And I called it the truck graveyard. And as a kid, I just absolutely love those old vehicles. I would play in them. A lot of them had old milk bottles, old black bottles in them, and the old milk, the old wooden milk crates. So as a kid, I just ate that stuff up. I absolutely loved it. And speaking of eat, I've definitely had my fair share of Pioneer Dairy ice cream through my lifetime. I think that was a steady diet growing up as a kid. The freezer was always full. There might have been nothing else in the house. We always had Pioneer Dairy ice cream.
That's right. Yeah. There's some remnants of those trucks still. There's not much, but there is some back there. Yeah, it's he's got, you know, in the building itself, there is one left. There, it's a cabin chassis. It was probably a trailer truck back in the day, but it's got to be either in the early 40s or late 30s. And Charlie had it running before he passed. I mean, it was everything was rotted on it, but he put a 1-gallon can next to the car. You know, Charlie could make anything work. Yeah, so he had it running, and you know, who knows what's up with that poor thing now, but it's sitting in there somewhere.
I love to go in there. It's a lot of great memories. The machinery was just always so cool.
Yeah,
I can still hear the sounds of it when I think about it, but how it sounded and everything that was going on, and I just absolutely loved it. Everybody was great. Love all the folks at the dairy.
Yeah, no doubt. So. Pete, let's take a quick break, and we'll come back. There we go.
Oh, Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Dunkin' Donut Shops of Westfield and the Sardinia family. It's nice to know that even as the world changes, Dunkin' Coffee remains the same at 7 convenient locations throughout Westfield. Support for community radio on WSKB is provided by Betts Plumbing and Heating Supply Company, an independent, family-owned wholesaler serving Westfield for over 50 years, specializing in plumbing, heating, and industrial piping supplies. On the web at BettsPlumbing.com or at 14 Coleman Avenue in Westfield.
Hi, it's Bob Plass, and I have Wow, It's Tuesday, every Tuesday, 6 to 8. Wow, It's Tuesday.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
I did it!
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
All right, folks, we're back with Ross Hazeltine. He is the gentleman for the Southwick Time Machine on Facebook. And you started a blog. How do I find that, sir?
Yes, if you go to, it's actually done on Blogger. So if you go to southwicktimemachine.blogspot.com, or you can, there's a link to it from the Facebook page. You can access it that way. So I started doing the blog. It just seemed like, for the longer stories, it just seemed like the blog made more sense to do it in that format. It just seems to lay it out better than on social media, which is more for like a little bit more for the shorter ones. So I hope that's not going to discourage some of the readers. I hope that they'll migrate over and check out the blog, which so far I believe has been well received.
Yeah, absolutely.
There's any readership over it. But yeah, the longer stuff, I'm migrating stuff onto that. It's just easier too for when you have pictures, which I wish a lot of stories unfortunately don't have pictures that go with them.
Right.
Which is unfortunate. And dialogue, I wish stories had more dialogue, but they don't have that either. But for the after-that longer stuff, some of it I will put, you know, I submit it to Southwoods for publication. I upload it to the blog page. I'm going to keep the Facebook one for more of the shorter stuff and more of the picture stuff. So
wonderful. So what do you think your best story was? For you personally. I mean, for me, it's going to be the dairy. I haven't even read it, but it's the dairy. So what do you think your best one was?
I really like the Granville Country Store one.
Yeah.
I'm really enjoying the one I'm writing now. It's about the ice houses in Southwick. More specifically, it's about the Berkshire Ice Company.
Yes.
A lot of fascinating history of how big that company got and the pull that it had in town. And then how it all came crashing down when refrigerators, were commercialized. So it's really fascinating history, all the stuff that, and the worker accidents and all that stuff, which was, and the horses on the ice. It's very fascinating how hard that work was. And, hundreds of people would flock to Southwick to get jobs there because they were really good paying jobs. But they were extremely dangerous. So I really enjoyed researching and writing that. So I'm hoping to have that finished hopefully this weekend. I'm going to submit that one to Southwoods as a two-parter just because of the length of it. I really like the Consolidated School story. I never went to Consolidated School, unfortunately, but I've always loved that building. I'm so glad that the town preserved it. Always absolutely love that building. And when I go to Southwick, I always make sure I go by it because I just love it so much. And I think people should just marvel at it. It's such a beautifully well-done building. And I actually wrote a story, which I'm going to go more in detail about the architect of that building. He did a lot of other great works. So I'm going to dive into him a little bit more.
That's interesting. I actually received, a gentleman must have been at a tag sale in town, and he dropped me off a picture of Consolidated School and the floor plan.
Oh, wow.
Signed by the gentleman that was the architect.
That's awesome.
And I will get you those pictures because I look at it, I have nothing to do with it. And I want to give it to the Historical Society, but I would assume they have so much stuff. I don't know, and it's all archived and sitting somewhere, and they really don't have a footprint to they have the old cigar barn there that they've preserved or pieces of it, but there's just so much history, I'm sure, sitting in boxes that we just don't see.
Yeah. I actually just sent the Historical Society not too long ago. I had some old matchbook covers from different businesses in Southwick.
Wow.
Like Babs and Cantels and like different places and whatnot. And I've been trying to dwindle down my Southwick collection because it's getting a little too big for me. I sent those up there, and thankfully they took them and are going to display them or whatnot. So I'm glad that they are, that we have a dedicated group of people working to preserve things. If you haven't been to the Southwick Museum, which I unfortunately have not, every time I go there, I haven't been able to get there where I was able to see it when it's been open. But I have seen some pictures. They have some really, really cool stuff, especially the old street sign. They have an old street sign from Sheep Pasture Road and Cottonmont Road. Stuff like that I just absolutely love. You know, but yeah, definitely, yeah, you definitely want to check it out. I'm dying to. So I'm going to make it a point. I'm going to hopefully come up for the Eastern States Expo, and hopefully then we'll be open. I'll be able to stop in there and...
Well, you have my cell phone now, so quite honestly, when that happens, please reach out, because I know people. Nice. I'm sure we can get you a tour of a few things that you're asking about. We have to, right?
And Joe, maybe you could tape another show with him in person at the Big E.
Oh, we could have some fun there. Absolutely.
Well, I'm so looking forward to it again. I had such a great time there. Me and my uncle went last year. Great time.
Yeah.
So that was another big thing. Riverside Park and the Big E.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. A lot of people talk bad about the Big E because of the traffic and stuff like that. And you know, I don't particularly like that. It's such a blessing that that exists. It's a huge blessing that the expo exists. So people should really look at that and just, you know.
Well.
You know, people don't like the traffic and stuff like that. But
they don't
really like their blessing to have it.
It is. We've been involved there for many years, and quite honestly, if it wasn't for the Big E, I don't know if I'd still be open. It does generate enough money, and it's about marketing. You know, we're 4 miles from the Big E, right? Maybe 5 at the most. So it works both ways. They've for years, you know, they had a lot of vendors in there, and I don't think they cared as much if they were local. But over the years now, they've really, really, concentrated on and making the local market work. Whether it's a concessionaire, whether it's someone selling trinkets or not antiques, but crafts, you know, they seem to have allowed a lot of Westfield, a lot of Southwick folks in there, which I think helps. And yeah, traffic can be an issue. Absolutely. It's expensive. Nothing's cheap anymore. I get it. My stuff's expensive there, you know, but I pay I walk to the King's Ransom every morning when I give them their percentage with a smile, with an absolute smile. They do know how to do things. The 4-H site is huge, and Southwick still has a lot of 4-H in Southwick. You know, we have houses going up left and right. I get it, but there still was a decent 4-H base in Southwick, and they're there. Yep.
My great grandfather, he was a painting decorator. He came from a broken home, and he was a painting. He became a very successful painter and decorator. He painted a lot of church in the area, including the Southwick National Church. He painted all the state replica state buildings of the Eastern State.
Wow.
He painted the Coliseum over there. So it was always a good thing, having that little bit of history with the Eastern States. So
that's nice.
Yeah, I like that.
So which story do you feel had the complete twist from where you were going?
Oh, there's been so many. See, a lot of times, like when I'm researching a story, like I said, I'll plug in like a date. And I'll just kind of, you know, just browse some census records or something that catches my eye, or an old, you know, newspaper, just flip through it or whatever. And usually I'll find something that is completely off base. And, you know, what I do is I use old school notebooks. I have hundreds of these old school notebooks, and I jot everything down with a pen. And I just have hundreds of them, and it just has all my messy notes. And I just, you know, I come back to it and I look, and then there's so many rabbit holes. Here I'm writing about one thing, and then here I'm thinking I'm nearing completion about that. But then this person or this event maybe triggered something down the road, and then I have this whole another massive story that's really a big part of it. I absolutely love that. It really, I don't want to say it catches you off guard, but it really adds an interesting twist to the story. So, but yeah. There's so many of those different ones. So.
And I said that in one or two of them, it starts off in Hartford, Connecticut. And then before it's over, you're in Southwick, you know, and that's in the 20s and 30s. So it wasn't a 10-minute ride.
Wasn't.
No, you know, we were really the boonies back then compared to today, and we're still the boonies. But I can't imagine in the 20s what it took to get to Southwick through Hartford.
Oh, yeah, most definitely. And it's amazing the hardships that people endured and stuff back then. And stuff like that just fascinates me. Just the will of the people and everything like that. I've always loved biographies growing up. A lot of people do like celebrity and stuff like that. I never really particularly cared for that. I like the everyday person. And I love those type of biographies. So I do want to dive into that more. We do have a lot of famous Southwickians that a lot of people may not realize. You know, we all know about Holcomb and the telescope.
Yep.
And but we've had some other folks too who were maybe not to that level of fame that he had, but they still deserve their rightful spot in history. So I want to dive into that some more. But yeah, it's there's a lot of twists and turns in the story. Sometimes I'll have a story that, you know, the Southwick piece of it becomes very small and it just expands outward. I usually abandon a lot of those stories. But sometimes I will go ahead and throw them in anyway. I probably have 90% of the stuff that I jot down, I usually abandon and like come back and revisit. Like I said, I have like probably, no lie, probably about 100 notebooks or so just of just random stuff that I come across that I thought that I found interesting. I thought maybe readers would find interesting that I want to explore. But sometimes like I might hit a dead end or I might get writer's block or whatever. So I'll take a break from that or I'll go down one rabbit hole that it leads me to another one that I'm way out here from being back here. I'm all over the place. So I try to, you know, I try to rein it in, or maybe I'm working on a story about a person who did something and then they might have a family member that got involved and now I'm going off on a whole different direction. So it's really interesting how the research pans out. So when you think you're going one direction, you're on a whole different thing. So it's just, it's amazing just what you can uncover, but it's very, very, difficult, the research part of it, but I do enjoy it. So, you know, it's a blessing that I get to do it, have the time and stuff.
Are you a morning guy with this? Are you an evening guy? Is it once a week? Is it?
Oh, I'm a morning guy. I usually work on it about, I get up about 4 a.m. Every morning and I sit outside. Thankfully, being blessed in the South, we've had a great February, minus the pollen. And yeah, I go outside in the backyard about 4 a.m. I sit out there and I don't always pick up where I left off. I might, you know, sometimes I'm working on 3 or 4 stories at the same time. I'll just kind of, whatever I feel for that day, I just kind of jump into. Then I might like pause that after an hour and, you know, jump into something else. I usually spend about 3 hours every morning doing it. On the weekends, sometimes I'm spending, you know, 8, 10, 12, 15 hours. I get so wrapped up and I just completely lose track of time. Because I just enjoy it so much. I'm just very passionate about it. So, yeah, it's very, very, very easy to lose track of time. So when I say it takes months to do a story, it really does. And I'm not just working on it here and there. I'm consistently working on stuff. So it may not be the same story, but I'm constantly doing something regarding a story.
So it's months and hundreds of hours.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
That's the research part of it. And now I'm trying to get better at the writing aspect of it because I do enjoy words. I do enjoy writing. But I was always focused on the research part of it, not necessarily the grammar, the punctuation, and so forth. I'm trying to get a little bit better at that. My main thing is I want to make sure the facts are straight. I always dot my I's, cross my T's. Before I publish something, I'm usually revisiting the final draft. You know, not again, not the punctuation, the grammar, the final draft of the facts. You know, I'm going back and I'm looking at the records. I'm looking at my spiral notebook with my notes, and I do that sometimes 3, 5, 10 different times before I'm confident. If I have any particular doubt, I certainly don't publish it. The Telltale Postcard is a good example of that. I sat on that story for a while because I just had this little piece. I just wasn't confident in my source. And then finally everything came together and I got that clarification that I needed and I was able to move forward. Now, I will say when I originally published that story under, I believe it was under a different name, I did make it very clear that that was the rough draft. And when I put the rough draft out there, that means I verified everything up to a point, but it's not the solid stuff. So I try to make that very clear to readers. So the stuff, so I went ahead and updated that story. I got the clarification I needed, and now I put it on the blog page.
Yeah, it's very intricate, that story. Like you just said, and I'm sure some of that reading is where you were probably waiting for, but you're very specific at, you know, in the court systems they're involved. And yeah, that was it was quite a story there.
Oh yeah, absolutely. That one took crazy twists and turns.
Yeah.
I thought the postcard piece of it was the end, but that particular story is a good example of what I hit on earlier. And I want to apologize to the viewers and listeners and yourself. I'm rambling on. But when I have a very bad thing when I'm writing stories because I'm a stickler for details, even if they might not apply to that story. So that's a good example. So I found myself when I wrote that story about the postcard, I found myself going off about the bombing that happened on Wall Street.
Yes.
From the Treasury building. And I found myself, I had actually a whole page. So I found that, and I knew about that story. I just had forgotten about it. But I went back and revisited. There's a lot of fascinating facts and stuff in that story. And a case has never been solved, by the way. And I just found it very interesting. So I found myself going off of the Varley tale That was the character in the story, or the Robinsons rather. And I found myself going off on the sub-treasury bombing, or it was actually the J.P. Morgan building across the street. But regardless, that's just a prime example of how easily you can get focused on something else. I had to really rein myself back in. But I did want to include that for the readers who may not know about it, and if they appreciate it like I did, and then they can further research that part of it on their own if they like. Because stuff like that, that was a big ordeal, and it's easier to get information about that.
Yeah, that was fascinating.
Investigating that, so you can go to their website. It's a lot of fantastic information.
Yeah, and you're right. It did go in a different direction. But, it, you know, I don't know. How do I say this nicely? you kept my attention, which is hard to do. So so reading that, and then when it twisted about the whole bombing, I'm like, what? Where did this come from? And then, and there's still marks today on the building, as you put in there. You know, that's fascinating in as itself, like you said, that I didn't know about that, and I don't think I would have known about it. But just to read it and go, what happened? Wait. Back up a paragraph, reread this, and I was like, oh, my God.
And the reason why they left the marks, I thought, was very fascinating. Why they didn't, J.P. Morgan didn't want to feel like the terrorists, if you will, or whoever did the bomb. He didn't want to cave to them, if you will.
Right.
So he marks on the building. It's no longer a bank today, but the marks are still there. And I just thought that was very interesting. But yes, I did go off on a tangent. I had to reel myself back, and I edited out a lot about that bombing. But that story too is another prime example. You know, I was working on the situation with the infidelity and the postcard and everything.
Yeah.
Then later on in life, as I kept researching, then you had the whole ordeal with another person. This lady was very attractive, and she was talking to Tom at one point, and she had a lot of admirers and a lot of attention, unwanted attention, you know. But she had a lot of attention, and this guy came. He was just infatuated, and then as you know in the story.
Yeah.
But in this, you know, this alcohol-fueled rage, and he was just completely obsessed. He went and, you know, shot at her parents. Thankfully, they didn't, die from the shooting. And, you know, he was probably going to kill her. And then later on, after he got out of jail, he's out on bail. He, you know, met up with her somehow in Westfield and wanted to die in a suicide pact with her. So that just shows you how the different directions go. So, you know, I could have ended it with the postcard trial and all that, but, you know, I don't like to do that. I always push further and dig deeper because I just have too much experience where I know the probability of something else existing is high. So I always make sure I go that step further. So, but yeah, that story's a fantastic example.
Yeah, very, very well detailed, you know, and as you say, college courses for this or just you loved it in high school, you bought a motorcycle and here we go.
Here we go. Yeah, the motorcycle. I love motorcycle riding. I love historic ruins. That's what started it.
Yeah.
And like I said, that trip that day to the Grand Blanc Country Store, I was actually sitting on the bench outside and I had my motorcycle parked there and I was enjoying some Grand Blanc Country Store cheese.
Yep.
And then I just had that. I ended up writing that article and that was published in Southwoods. And then that right there gave me the idea as I sat on that bench that, you know what, why am I, you know, Southwick is so great. I'm so passionate. But why don't I just make the focus that? And then I did stumble. I didn't know what I was going to call it. I did come up with a couple different names and whatnot. And then finally, a little bell went off. I want to say it was probably 3 weeks later after I tried different names. It's how the Time Machine came about. So, but the original title was called From Today's Motorcycle Ride. And there was a lot of different things published under that, primarily on social media.
Yeah. No, you've done a great job. We're like I said, I can't say enough about it. And I don't read. So for me to read anything, it's huge, literally. Great job. I'm speechless once again. It's just, and as Pete will tell you, that's rare.
There's a reason why people like Paul Harvey, The Rest of the Story, or Mike Rowe, The Way I Heard It, or sites like yours, or, you know, there's a reason that people like them is because, A, most humans are curious, and if you're not, you're kind of like probably dead. And two, is people want to find out more about where they live because in this age of you really don't know your neighbors, any way they can find out more about where they live is just a godsend nowadays.
Yeah, most definitely. And like I said, I have published stories where I got a lot of negative feedback about it, but most of it's been positive. And a lot of people do genealogy and family trees and so forth. And I get a lot of feedback from people like, wow, I didn't know that about my ancestor or what have you. And what a great addition that makes to our family tree, our family story, or whatever they're working on. So I do get a lot of that. Like I said, I really love when readers, they might have something to add or fill in a blank or have a picture of maybe the person in the story or the house that it took place in, or just, you know, just whatever. So, and I try to do stories. I did write about Martha Vining. We all know about the axe killing of Lester Vining. That was, you know, a tragic story. It's been done over and over and over. But there's a lot of misinformation out about that story that really bothered me. And I don't like misinformation going around. So that's why I wrote that particular story, because I wanted to put out the actual facts out there as for what I did for my research. So I know it's talked about a lot during the ghost tours, and it's a common story people talk about in town. That legend never goes away. So I want to do that. But I always try to focus on stuff like I wrote about, you know, the Holcomb attempted murder on his wife and stuff like that, that people might not be aware of. And that's the kind of stuff that I like to write about, the stuff that people may not be familiar with. You know, 99% of the people in Southwick, especially older folks, probably know about the Lester Vining murder with the axe.
Right.
But they, you know, but I bet you those same 99.9% of people don't know about the attempted murder regarding Holcomb. So, yeah, Henry Holcomb.
That was
a good story.
So the old cemetery, we've been restoring the stones there. So next time you're up, you'll have to take a good look. And it's funny because the gentleman doing it, you know, we talk quite a bit. And they really, the town's gotten behind his project. So we're straightening stones. There's a ton of work happening. But he'll tell you that, you know, when it's a refinish a stone or get it white again and clean it, there's bullet holes on the stones. And, wow. You know, and we chuckle about, so, you know, was someone grieving over someone and the husband or wife showed up and, who knows the history behind the bullet holes, but
right. It's
just amazing what's in that old cemetery. And now you can actually read a lot of the stones. You know, no one lived past 25, 26 back in the day, you know, and there's 12 kids there in that burial within 5-6 years of each other. You're right. There's a ton of history in town. Some of it makes it to the paper, and we're fortunate that we have you snooping around and finding these great little old stories. And then there's stuff that, you know, we'll never know about, right? But, yeah, we have a lot to do when you come up. You better spend an extra day because I got a lot of places to take you.
And, I would absolutely love that.
Yeah, yeah.
The old cemetery, what I really like about the old cemetery, and I wish this occurred today, but unfortunately, the way the direction of the world, it'll never happen. I love that they would put on the old gravestones sometimes – what happened to the person?
Yes.
They exploded on a gunpowder mill.
Yeah.
They got, you know, they drowned by a tidal wave, you know, what have you, you know, stuff like that I find very fascinating.
And there is some verbiage on some of those up there. There really is, which I thought was crazy. I'm like, look at, oh my God, or they died from what disease they died from. It's on there on some of those. So yeah, we'll spend some time together. You'll be impressed. We'll have some fun and we'll add to your book. How many more years you figure you have in you?
I would like to write a book, but the problem with writing a book is I don't know what to include in it because the history just keeps going. There's just so much.
Right.
And I would hate to have overlooked something that should have been included in the book. But there are some great history books that were written about Granville, Suffield, Westfield in particular that I really enjoy reading. And I have never found anything remotely close to that for Southwick. So I certainly would like to take a stab at that maybe in the future, but I think that's a long way off.
Sure. Yeah. Do you have any of our anniversary books, the 250th or the 200th or any of those?
I have the old bicentennial book that was 1970.
Yep.
I have that.
You have that?
Yeah, and I have, of course, the Southwick Revisited and the Southwick, the newer books.
Yep, good. A lot of great pictures in there.
A lot of great pictures.
Yeah.
Love old pictures of them up, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah, we're very fortunate.
Encourage readers to share stuff like that. So
technology is what's saving you right now. Quite honestly.
Right? Yeah.
Which is wonderful. It's good to see it actually being used for the right reasons.
Yeah, and we have the Freedom of Information Act, which is a powerful tool. And, you'd be surprised what you get out of court records and, reading old wills and stuff like that just are loaded with information, stuff like that. The problem with that is some of them are hard to read because they were just obviously written in cursive because there was no typing back then. It's very, very, very interesting stuff.
And I'm assuming a lot of this isn't free. You're spending money out of your pocket.
That's the part I don't like. Yes, it's very, very, very expensive. I'm not a wealthy person by any means.
Right.
But I do spend a lot of money each month accessing the tools and the documents and stuff like that. But it's a passion, so like a motorcycle, I feel it's an investment in that. But yes, unfortunately, it's a never-ending payout to access this stuff.
Sure.
That's the big downside of it.
Well,
that's not even counting the expense of the time and everything like that, which I don't mind. But yeah, I do have to pay a lot for the materials that I'm accessing.
Yeah, I can imagine. Yeah, because nothing's just sitting there anymore. Everything's got a fee to it.
There is, absolutely. But I mean, what a blessing to be able to have access to it.
Yeah, absolutely.
And again, I just want, everything I put out there is certainly public information. It just takes a lot of digging and a lot of patience to go through it all, And, a lot of people I noticed, if you go to like Find a Grave or Wikipedia and sites like that, Ancestry is a good example. There's a lot of misinformation out there. So I make it a habit of not going to those sources. I correct a lot when I do find mistakes, but people are so quick to throw up stuff without verifying. I don't do that because I know that what I'm writing about are real people and descendants of real people. So I always keep that in the back of my head, regardless of what I'm writing about, even with landmarks and stuff like that. So
if it's on the internet, it's not true? What?
Wait. A lot of cases. You'd be surprised if people are just so quick, and I don't know if it's just that rush society and people just throw stuff, but there's a lot of stuff that's just incorrect. So you got to be really careful. Even in gravestones, a lot of people think a date on a gravestone is 100% accurate. It's not.
It's not.
Well, how did the newspaper report the death a date, 3 days before the date on the gravestone? Obviously, there's an incorrect thing on the gravestone. That happened quite a bit. That was actually a frequent problem.
So the newspapers make mistakes? Did I?
Oh, okay. The census make mistakes. They're going with information that somebody gave them. Death certificates are frequently incorrect.
Yeah.
A lot of wrong information back then. You have to remember, too, it took a lot longer for people to get to places, information took a lot of time to travel. So when people were going to the undertaken rooms, for example, at Lamps and Furniture Company in Westfield or whatnot, by the time the information caught up, the process of death certificates and whatnot, the dates were off by a day or two or three. That's happened quite frequently. A lot of misinformation, whether people are born. So you really gotta really cross-check stuff. So when I look at death certificates, birth certificates, newspaper clippings, articles and things, I'm trying to find multiple sources to verify that one source, because I don't want to publish anything that's incorrect.
True.
And if I'm in serious doubt, I make that known by listing it as a rough draft piece.
Wonderful.
So I don't want to do a disservice to history or anybody.
Absolutely. Understood. Well, we're going to be winding down now. So is there anything else you'd love to add?
Well, again, I appreciate being here. I appreciate all the readers who take the time to, to read the blogs and the postings and to comment on them, and especially the folks who provided pictures or additions to the stories and stuff. I encourage people to keep on doing that. And like I said, I accept good or bad feedback. And I just really appreciate people taking the time. I hope people continue to enjoy the Southwick Time Machine. We've been getting a lot of followers. So that shows me that there is an interest from people. Not too long ago, I heard that actually it was a couple of years ago, I guess, when Mrs. Murphy's was open, I heard that there was a lot of people talking about the Southwick Time Machine around the counter in there. And
I bet there was.
So there you go.
Wonderful. Yeah, unfortunately, they are open. They're doing great, but they never reopened their indoor seating. So it's just a drive-through now on the weekends and during the week a couple of days. But, I bet this was a conversation piece, no doubt about it. Now it's not at the Notch. There's over by the transfer station. They have a couple chairs, so I'm pretty sure that's where the disciples went, and the town government now meets there every morning at 7 a.m. to discuss the world. But, yeah, it works out well.
Not to make things longer, but I was very surprised too. We were talking about like controversial stories or whatnot. The most controversial piece that I have to say that I got a lot of feedback on that was negative, that I was very surprised about, was when I posted a picture of Donald Prifty's business card.
Oh, really?
I didn't expect the negative reaction that I got from that. I was very surprised. I received a lot of hate mail based on that. And I was kind of shocked. You could deem it as inappropriate, especially by today's standards and whatnot, but it was a card that he used, and it was certainly public knowledge. He wasn't ashamed to share it out. And I didn't know him personally. I knew of him.
Right.
So I don't think he would have had any problem with that. I don't know him, so I'm just speculating as far as that goes. But yeah, I was surprised. That was probably the most hate mail I received was from that. A lot of people told me it was in bad taste, and it was highly inappropriate.
Well, unfortunately, they don't know the history behind it. And the society we live in today isn't what we lived in 10 years ago. It just isn't. So, Trust me, I got plenty of business cards out there that you would love to see that I haven't posted, because just for that reason, someone would have a problem with it, you know. But it is what it is. Well, sir, it was great having you on the show. I appreciate you taking the time out of your day, and we'll hook up at the Big E and we'll have some fun.
Excellent. I look forward to it. Thank you so much.
All right, Pete, that's going to do it for today, and hopefully I'm back in a couple weeks. Thank you.
Time machine.